Good morning and welcome to Senate Judiciary. We're going to start the day by opening the public hearing on House Bill 1631 and recognize the prime sponsor, Representative Schroeder. Good morning, Representative.
Good morning. Thank you, Madam Chair and members of the committee. I very much appreciate the opportunity to come before you today to speak in support of House Bill 1631. Madam Chair, this is a bill that in one version or another has now been passed on to the Senate from the House seven times dating back to 2008. Seven times the House has voted with broad and growing bipartisan support to reduce marijuana possession penalties to a violation. Last year, a bill essentially identical to this one passed the House Criminal Justice and Public Safety Committee 12-3 and overwhelmingly passed the House by over an 80% vote. Here are the terms of the bill as before you today. Instead of decriminalizing 1 ounce or less of marijuana, as Vermont and Massachusetts have done, and as this chamber, or as the House has voted for previously, it follows last year's recommendations by the Criminal Justice and Public Safety Committee to reduce the amount being decriminalized to 1/2 ounce or less. And now those are terms that that this committee, of course, discussed last year as well. Mm-hmm. It also adds graduated fines for subsequent offenses, $100 for the first offense, $200 for a second offense, and $500 for a third and subsequent offenses. And last year I went through and I spelled out a lot of the specifics within the bill in front of you guys, and given the identical nature, I'm not going to waste your time on a lot of that today, but I'm going to reiterate a couple of things. I've said it before and I'll say it again. The best argument for this bill comes straight out of our New Hampshire Constitution. Part 1, Article 18 says all penalties ought to be proportioned to the nature of the offense. In other words, the punishment ought to fit the crime. Voters continue to demonstrate their belief that the appropriate punishment, at least for adults, would be no penalty at all. According to last month's WMUR Granite State poll, 65% of New Hampshireites support the outright legalization of marijuana, with only 30% opposed. But this bill does not legalize marijuana, and it's important that we all understand that. House Bill 1631 simply reduces penalties. According to that same Granite State poll, a whopping 72% of New Hampshire voters are in support of simple decriminalization. Under current law, possessing even a tiny amount of marijuana is a Class A misdemeanor, punishable by up to a year in jail and a fine of up to $2,000. In Maine, marijuana possession hasn't been a criminal offense since 1976. According to surveys conducted by the U.S. Substance Abuse and Mental Health Administration, Maine has a lower rate of teen marijuana use than New Hampshire. We all understand that marijuana is not a harmless substance, but we should also understand, if we're honest with ourselves, that the harms associated with marijuana are not sufficient to justify a criminal punishment. If we are truly concerned about abuse of dangerous drugs like heroin, cocaine, OxyContin, and meth, why would we want to continue squandering limited law enforcement and criminal justice resources on cases involving simple possession of marijuana? Madam Chair and members of the committee, I would conclude by saying that regardless of what you think about marijuana or marijuana legalization, I hope we can all agree that our current penalties are excessive, they're harsh, and they ought to be reduced. We should pass this bill so we can allow police and courts to focus their limited resources on more serious crimes, like the opioid epidemic. For offenses involving simple marijuana possession, a fine would be just fine for New Hampshire. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your testimony this morning, Representative. Are there any questions from the committee? Senator Catawba.
Thank you, Madam Chair. You just made a statement that marijuana is now a harmless substance. Where's the data coming from?
I think you said it's not.
It's not a harmless
substance. Yeah,
it's not. It's not. Where's that data coming from that it's not?
That it's not a harmless substance? Well, I mean, I think that there's been numerous different studies. I think in particular, one thing that we see is we don't want young people taking part in or using marijuana. The studies at the same time, relate to things like alcohol and show that the harms are often far less.
Senator Pierce?
Representative, you said that this bill was very similar to the one that the House passed last year.
Yeah.
But I know in looking at the record that it came out of committee with an ITL recommendation, and then that was overturned on the floor. What was the House committee's recommendation? I mean, if it's the same bill, why did they pass it so well, 12-3, I think you said last year, but chose to recommend ITL this year? The same committee, right?
Well, so I can try to answer that question. I think it's a good question. Thank you very much for asking. The first thing I would say is that heading into this committee hearing last year, it's worth pointing out that there were some things that may have amounted to typos within the bill that Senator Daniels had caught, and that this time around the changes that were originally recommended by Senator Daniels last year, that we brought an amendment for to the committee, have been made and are included in the bill. That has very little substantial change, though, to anything that the committee would have changed their minds about in the House. I don't know exactly. It's difficult to say what took place on the days of the votes within the committee. There are at least one member of the Criminal Justice Committee behind me. Different from previous years, I wasn't noticed when the votes were cast. I didn't get to see or hear the conversations at place. I think that there has been an idea put forward that because of the opioid epidemic and because of the task force that was put together over the summer and some of the bills that had been brought forward by the task force, that addressing an issue like decriminalization of marijuana are bad optics. However, I think the people that have been working on this legislation from before I even entered the House have been arguing that the resources should be placed toward combating opioids and harsher drugs from the beginning, since prior to 2008. So I don't think that should have been what may have caused a different vote out of the committee, but I think that may have been an initial argument. Okay.
Follow up?
And I know that last year's bill, at least when it got to the Senate floor, included a provision saying that the violation of this chapter should not be used to deny public assistance, financial aid, things like that. Mm-hmm. And because the base reasoning of the bill is that a kid makes a mistake, it shouldn't haunt him the rest of his life. I don't see that in here. Was that deliberately left out, taken out by the committee? This is as introduced, so.
Correct, yeah. When the Senate took this issue up on the Senate floor last year, it appeared that this was that clause was ultimately one of the arguments of the day that led to the table. The clause that in question is only in place in one state, as I understand it, that have decriminalized around the country, and I think the questions related to it were apt. The goal, I think, the aim of the legislation on the whole is in line with what you mentioned. For instance, not ruining somebody's life as a result of this. Although some of the other changes that both committees, both in the Senate and the House, have looked at in years past, things like the graduated fines in this instance, are things that create a bit of a track record that go against that idea already. For instance, if you're a member of law enforcement or you aim to be a member of law enforcement or life safety, such as police and fire, that these offenses can already stick with you through the DMV track record and prevent somebody that otherwise would be hired in those professions.
Are there any further questions? Senator Daniels.
Thank you. If there was a form that asked if you were convicted of a drug crime, have you been convicted of a drug crime, and someone was subject to this, would the answer have to be yes?
Not in the case of it's a simple violation.
Are there any further questions?
Okay. Yeah, just an update on one of the questions we would ask. It came out of committee, by the way, the ITL 76.
Okay. Mm-hmm. It's okay. Senator Pierce, did you have another question? Okay, I just have a comment. Are you aware that the Senate has passed the decriminalization bill when it's headed to the House?
Yes, thank you for the. Do you mind if I respond to that just briefly?
Sure.
Just because I believe it might relate to how you guys would view this.
Mm-hmm.
I've had a lot of conversations with law enforcement about this bill prior to the one the Senate passed, and I appreciate very much the effort on the whole the committee and the Senate has put in on this issue. There are different chiefs of police I've spoken with. The first year I sponsored the bill, I heard from a lot of them. I had very open and lengthy conversations with a lot of people, and the phrase that was commonly brought up was, if you look at somebody getting picked up on simple possession of marijuana, they're not really usually being charged for it. Maybe they end up being convicted of something else. And, the idea of the toolbox, comes in. We like having that in our toolbox. And specifically, though, that the courts are finding people and charging them, ultimately convicting them of other things, not just the simple possession of marijuana. Already then, that says that today the judges can pretty much let people off on these things. But the furthering of the conversations that took place with different police chiefs I've spoken with came down to times in their life that they may have gone through, say, family court and a divorce or something like that. And the issues that they've had just once they are within the system of the court and dealing with things that day and the way that things can swirl out of control and do their own kinds of damage. And I think the idea is really to prevent having to get into that mix as much as possible and to save the resources associated with being put there.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate it.
Oh, wait a second. We have some more questions. Senator Pierce.
To follow up on that comment, I believe, if memory serves, the Senate bill just removed the reference to Class A when it says, and it can be charged as a misdemeanor, which then is implied gives the prosecutors the discretion to plead it down to a violation. This makes it explicit that it's a violation. So I think that might be the distinction between, is that your sense of what the distinction between the two bills is?
Okay. Thank you very much.
Seeing no further questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you for the time.
The chair will call Representative Cushing.
Thank you, Madam Chair, members of the committee. For the record, I'm Representative Rennie Cushing from Hampton, here in support of this bill. I think Representative Schroeder can't cover a lot of the details of this particular legislation. I know it's familiar to you because it is, as he said, it's the same bill that came before. It's the same bill that came back before us to the Criminal Justice Committee of the House. And I will, anticipate any questions from you, Representative Pierce, excuse me. I can tell you a little bit of the how it was dealt with in my committee. When after the public hearing, there was a lot of support for the bill. There was some concerns were raised about the amount of money, the amount of marijuana that would be decriminalized. And I went to try to meet the concerns of members of my committee about that amount, and I brought in an amendment that would reduce the amount from 1/2 to 1/4 ounce. I thought that would satisfy the concerns that were expressed, and that in fact passed my committee. And the committee adopted that amendment and voted to recommend ought to pass with that amendment to the House. Subsequent to that, there was a motion to to reconsider that and take up another amendment. That amendment was brought in that looked at the matter of the decriminalization of the gifting or the sale, if you will, of less than an eighth of an ounce. The concern expressed was that, well, we don't want people selling drugs, notwithstanding the fact, or selling marijuana, notwithstanding the fact that under the statute, giving someone or passing a joint to another person would be considered sale and distribution of drugs and would still be a crime under this statute. We wanted to, you know, or I'm one of the people who wanted to include that as part of it, you know, a small amount as part of the decriminalization process. That reconsidered amendment to include, to recriminalize the distribution passed, and upon that, the bill itself, the committee voted, as you can say, 8-7 or 6-5 to inexpedient to legislate. My sense is it was not voted inexpedient. It was the reason it was voted inexpedient to legislate is because we got hung up on whether or not one should be criminalized for sharing a joint, and that's basically it. As you know, that as you can see from the records here, that the House overwhelmingly overturned the committee report, voted to pass this bill. I would say that this is a piece of legislation that I first remember voting in favor of in 1997 when Representative Robertson first brought it before the House. And as it's been alluded to, this has passed this House, a bill similar to this has passed the House seven times. I think if we look around, New Hampshire's kind of an outlier in this, where because there are 19 states have decriminalized possession of small amounts of marijuana. We're the only New England state that's left that still treats it as a crime. I think we just look to the tragedy that happened recently in Nashua and in Valley Street, where you had a 26-year-old man who was ended up being arrested because he had a small amount of marijuana in his pocket and was charged with a class A misdemeanor, held on $100 bail, ends up dying in Valley Street, and he never should have been arrested in the first place. I just think it didn't make any sense for us to criminalize the possession of a small amount of marijuana. And we ought to, if we're serious about substance abuse, we ought to keep our eyes on focus on the opioid crisis and not, squander precious resources trying to, arrest and prosecute people for use of a small amount of marijuana.
Okay, Senator Pierce for a follow-up.
You have to refresh my recollection, if you could. When the Senate considered the bill last year, at what level were we? Were we a quarter ounce, half ounce? I just don't recall.
My recollection is a half ounce. But because I do know what happened last year in the House. Last year in the House, my committee also recommended, the committee recommended changing the amount from one quarter. From one half to one quarter. It went to the floor of the House, and the House ended up going with the original one half ounce and sending it to the House, and sending it to the Senate in that version, I believe. And someone kind of only watched what went on in the Senate when they took up this bill last year. I'm not really sure how it all unfolded, but.
Senator Catalba?
Thank you. Representative Christian, you made the statement that sharing a joint.
The what?
Sharing a joint.
Yes.
I know what a joint is. Thank you. How many joints are in a half an ounce?
I don't really know.
Depends, I think, on personal preference.
I'll follow up to that, Madam Chair. Yes. I recollect when the bill came into the Senate before, that 1 ounce would get something like 24 cigarettes out of it, of joints.
Yeah.
So you're talking 10 or 12 that you're sharing.
Yeah. I believe that.
Okay.
I don't know.
Thank you.
Are there any further questions? Representative, I see you don't have a copy of the bill in front of you, but I do have a question. I'm looking on page 3, the Controlled Drug Act and the penalties, and I see in the section beginning B, which states that a person may be sentenced to a maximum term of prison for not more than 20 years and a fine of not more than $300,000, that section 6, dealing with marijuana in the quality of 5 pounds or more, including any adulterants, has been removed, and it's been moved down into the section, section C, in which it says a person may be sentenced to a maximum term of imprisonment of not more than 7 years and $100,000. And it says here, section beginning on line 32, number 5, marijuana in a quantity of 5 pounds or more. So I see where they've, in essence, taken away the 20 years. But my question is, what if somebody has 4.5 pounds of marijuana? What is the penalty for that, or does that come under the misdemeanor section?
I'll take a guess. I think possession, I don't know, maybe it could be possession with intent to sell, right?
That's not what it says. It says that they're looking at, in case of a violation involving any of the following, a person may be sentenced to a maximum of imprisonment, not more than 7 years, a fine of not more than 100,000. It does not say marijuana in a quantity of up to 5 pounds. It says marijuana in a quantity of 5 pounds or more. So what do you do with someone who has 4.5 pounds of marijuana? What is the penalty for somebody having that quantity? You can't argue that at that point 4.5 pounds is something you're going to share. That is something that someone is probably going to be selling, and it seems that there's no penalty for that, the way this bill reads.
I believe the penalty would be, I suspect I'd have to look it over, sorry, I don't refresh myself, would be a class A misdemeanor.
Okay.
It would still be a
felony.
It's a felony?
It would be a felony, okay.
All right. Then it's a felony.
Thank you. All right, thank you. Are there any further questions? Seeing none, thank you, Representative. Representative Kane, I see that you've signed up, but I want to make sure you do not wish to speak. Okay, the chair will call, is it possible for Liz Broch, is that correct, and Molly Brown, since you're both from Katie, would you like to come up together? Thank you.
Good morning. Good morning. I appreciate the opportunity.
Oh, excuse me, could you please introduce yourself?
Of course, sorry. My name is Elizabeth Brochu. I'm Youth Services Coordinator at Communities for Alcohol and Drug for Youth, also known as Kate.
My name is Molly Brown. I am a member of the Youth Advisory and Advocacy Council at Kate.
Thank you.
Well, I would like to appreciate the opportunity to share my concerns regarding this important issue. And thank you to the committee members and the service team. As an educator, I have to ask, why would we want to decriminalize marijuana? We are in the midst of a serious opiate epidemic in our state. To decriminalize a drug that multiplies the risk of heroin addiction by 3 times confuses me. As a youth services coordinator and an educator in the field of substance misuse prevention, I feel strongly that the passage of House Bill 1631 would only serve to add to the problem of addiction. Over the past 7 years, I have watched the effect of decreased perception of risk on youth. Through academic problems, school truancy, juvenile justice issues and social problems, and even mental health issues, including anxiety and depression. In the Pemmy-Baker region, we do the teen assessment survey, and the youth reported the use of substances on one, the number one reason is stress reduction, and the second reason is to feel less depressed. Youth have shared they believe marijuana will help them feel better, and it ends up making them feel worse. I have parents call me beside themselves with worry about their child's marijuana use. I talk to teachers concerned about marijuana's effect on their students' grades and extracurricular activities. This drug is crossing all socioeconomic boundaries and negatively impacting our communities, yet we are considering removing barriers and reducing penalties. If we are to effectively address the drug crisis, we must work to prevent all drug use. Science tells us that the developing teen brain is especially vulnerable to addiction. That's why addiction is often referred to as the disease of adolescence. In your packet, there is an insert, and it's titled, Why Prevention? The Escalation of Drug Use During the Teen Years. You will see the surge of drug use during adolescence between the ages of 12 and 20, and the use tapers off during the rest of the lifespan. According to the National Center on Addiction and Substance Abuse, 9 out of 10 individuals who struggle with addiction began drinking, smoking, and using other drugs before they turned 18. This illustrates the need for more prevention and not less. If we decriminalize marijuana, we will be sending the wrong message regarding risk factors and opening the floodgates to increased access and use by our vulnerable youth population. Last fall, the New Hampshire Bureau of Drug and Alcohol Services, also known as BDAS, conducted young adult assessments targeting young adults between 18 to 25, a demographic that is often difficult to reach. I sat in 3 forums in the central New Hampshire region, and these young adults felt strongly that marijuana was indeed a dangerous point of entry into their lives. Many of the young adults struggling with addiction confirmed that they started using marijuana at a very young age. Teenagers and preteens are watching what we as adults do and say. Decriminalizing marijuana for adults will send the wrong message for the youth. A better option would be to refer adults who are arrested for marijuana-related offenses to alternative sentencing programs where they can be educated on the risks and harms of use and held accountable for without criminalization. As an educator, I'm very concerned about the consequences of decriminalization on the health and safety of our youth and state. I fail to see the positive outcome. I can only foresee harm to our children and youth. I ask you to kill House Bill 1631 and uphold that marijuana use is illicit drug use. Thank you for your consideration.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Ms. Brown, I see that you also have written testimony. What I'm going to ask you to do instead of reading it is if you could just paraphrase it.
Yes, ma'am.
Because we will, we're not accepting this bill today, so we'll have time to read the testimony.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Well, today I would like to present to you the teen's perspective on this really confusing issue. I, along with my fellow peers, are in opposition to House Bill 1631. As I mentioned before, I'm a member of the Youth Advisory and Advocacy Council at Katy, and I have the great opportunity to speak here today of the 11 members that are part of the group. Decriminalizing marijuana shows our generation that it's a harmless drug, but it is not harmless and it impacts our generation negatively. We're always told to not do drugs and just say no, but it's very insincere when what we see as teenagers coming from the legislature is decriminalizing drugs. Speaking as a teenager, it's really confusing. There are so many conflicting messages, not only from the legislature, but from school and media. And many of our peers are using marijuana because it is normalized in all of these areas. They believe they won't be penalized. If it is seen as a harmful drug, youth will see it as a green light to use. And even terminology such as decriminalization, legalization may mean something to you and I, but to the average teenager, there's no difference in their mind between what those would mean for drug use. New Hampshire ranks in the top 10 states for past month marijuana use among 12 to 20-year-olds. So obviously marijuana is already a huge problem. We believe that if House Bill 1631 is passed, there'll be a ripple effect of negative consequences among youth and adults. Perception of risk is a very strong prevention strategy, and when perception of risk is low, substance use will increase. If adults' perception of risk is low, why would teenagers be any different? In order to keep us safe, perception of risk and disapproval needs to be higher and not lower. Parents and adults and policymakers, leaders, they all need to be aware that young people need a lot of guidance in this area and what we should and should not do. Social norms are changing every day. We know marijuana is a drug that has a very high abuse rate. About 60% of high school seniors do not view marijuana as harmful, when in reality, marijuana rewires our brain for addiction. When THC is smoked or ingested, it acts on specific molecular targets on your brain cells called cannabinoid receptors. These receptors are ordinarily activated by chemicals that are naturally produced in your body, and they're very similar to THC. So this causes confusion with the receptors. This can directly worsen symptoms of anxiety, depression, and even schizophrenia. The younger the onset of use, also the more damaging it can be to these cell receptors. We cannot forget also that marijuana is adding to a larger problem of addiction. It is a gateway drug as well as a risk multiplier. Whether people believe it or not, the fact is marijuana introduces youth and adults to a high, and that high can lead to drug dependency. It also puts kids around people that use harder drugs, which can be a huge risk factor in their dependency. We also know that marijuana, people that are addicted to marijuana are 3 times more likely to be addicted to heroin. We can see through the DEA shows us that marijuana is a Schedule I drug. So that means that it's on the same level as heroin, LSD, and other very harmful drugs. So viewing marijuana as not as harmful can show us through the likelihood of people becoming addicted to heroin is just not the case. Marijuana has surged in the past decade, and we are not surprised. Not only has youth use increased, but a study done by the National Institution of Alcohol Abuse and Alcoholism showed marijuana use among U.S. adults has doubled over the past decade. We believe this surge is due to marijuana being viewed as less harmful than other drugs. Some kids are lucky enough, like myself, to have parents that talk to them about not using drugs at home, but a lot of kids don't have that support system. Recently, we've been hearing many parents feel that they'd rather have their kids smoke marijuana than drink alcohol, which is a seriously dangerous idea because, both are harmful, but kids tend to pair drugs, so they would not only be using marijuana, but they tend to pair marijuana and alcohol together, which is an extremely dangerous combination. No matter what, there will be teenagers and adults who will make the choice to use drugs, but please think of the youth that do not want to get into the trouble. If marijuana is decriminalized, more New Hampshire teens and adults will use because it reduces the fear of consequences. Many of my peers don't use marijuana because of getting into trouble with the law is just a huge risk that they are not willing to take. And this would break down those barriers. There are other options to help youth who do experiment through juvenile justice programs, such as Katie's restorative justice program. This court diversion program gives first-time offenders the opportunity of intervention, education, accountability, and prevention of further use. When we read House Bill 1631, we were concerned about the no mentions of drug education among youth. The very big concern on the field of prevention. We know as legislators you need to consider so many opposing views, and your goal is to protect all of us. In order to effect real change in New Hampshire, in the New Hampshire drug crisis, we cannot give amnesty to any drug. If you had the opportunity to prevent substance use, wouldn't you want to? Please continue to hold all of us accountable, including adults. We ask that you kill House Bill 1631, and by doing so, you will close the road to addiction. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your testimony this morning. Are there any questions? Senator Lansky.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, lady. You mentioned that New Hampshire still has the highest rate of marijuana use among teens in New England.
Top,
is that
top 10 states.
Top 10 states. So clearly, or it seems that the penalties aren't working. Do you advocate harsher penalties?
Yes, I would say so. The message that's being sent to teenagers is very confusing, and so when the lines are muddy for them, yeah, it can be very confusing if there are not harsher penalties. And I believe that penalties and punishments are part of the learning process of prevention.
Thank you.
Any
further
questions? Senator Pierce.
Mr. I want to go back to something that I think the both of you said, but looking at your statement, saying that, to decriminalize a drug that multiplies the risk of heroin addiction by three times, and then you cite the Center for Disease Control, the CDC. Is there a CDC report that comes to that conclusion?
Yes, they do have that. Yes, and it cites that for heroin addiction, alcohol is two times. It helps with it lead to heroin addiction. Marijuana three times. Cocaine, I believe, 15 times more likely. And the prescription drug is 40 times more likely to become addicted to heroin. But marijuana is three times more likely to become addicted to heroin.
Can you make that report available to the committee?
Yes,
I can. And my question is that the three times figure, I read the report, and obviously you have, but did the CDC conclude that relationship is merely correlative, or is it a causal relationship?
I honestly don't know that answer, but I can find that answer for you.
Yeah, I can maybe when you get the report, maybe you see that.
Follow-up?
Yes, follow-up. You also stated that, the facts are that, and I think Representative Cushing testified to this, that you know, we're the only state in New England that has not decriminalized possession of small amounts of marijuana. But so, looking at the other side of the coin, those states around us that have they seen an increase in their opioid problem directly as a result of decriminalizing marijuana? And I guess it kind of ties back to the whole, is it a correlative relationship or a causal relationship?
Right.
What have been because we see, opioid problem is a problem everywhere.
Right.
Can it be tied in those other states that decrimmed? Can it be tied back to decrim?
Well, we'll have to talk to our correspondents in the other states about that. We'll have to get that answer from you.
Okay.
I don't know.
Follow-up?
Yes, please. I believe that you had, I apologize, Ms. Brown, you said that there's a certain percentage of teenagers who today think that marijuana is no big deal.
60% of high school seniors.
Okay, 60%. They already think that without decriminalization, even with the penalties that are on the books today. But so are you saying that it is likely that 60% is going to go higher if we do decrim?
I would believe that's the case. I live right near Plymouth, so there's a therapeutic cannabis distribution center coming in there. Mm-hmm. So I think it's factors such as that, along with decriminalization, that the perception of risk is low already, and I believe with decriminalization that would raise.
I also feel, just to follow up, the legalization in Colorado and Washington State, and then the decriminalization in 16 other states nationwide has really decreased the perception of risk on our youth and even adults in the states that have not yet decriminalized, and that's why use is going up. And I really feel that it's because of the lead that these other states are taking that are really lessening the perception of the risk. And that is a big factor that we need to raise perception of risk to stop drug use. This is a big issue, and we need to help fight this issue.
Is there, it sounds intuitive, right? Mm-hmm. But do you have evidence? Is there a CDC report that says that
The perception of risk
is rising because of decriminalization?
Yes, and I believe Kate Fry will be speaking to that in her testimony.
Okay, thank you.
Senator
Catawba. Thank you, Chair. I'm just looking at the chart that was handed out. Who gave us this one? Yeah. And I'm noticing that the person's age is over 34. Mm-hmm. It seems to decrease a hell of a lot compared to what we have today. Is that because of the availability? Possibly, if you look at this chart, that this age group is different than the other age group. If you're going to be smoking marijuana, probably smoking the rest of your life, if you like it. Mm-hmm. I'm looking at people over 64, I guess it's 64, who are really, really small, who are doing it. Are they going to another substance? In other words, are they going to heroin or something else other than marijuana when this increase is going down?
Well, this is a chart for all substance use.
Okay.
That is, it is, teens will be using alcohol and other drugs. And unless we raise the perception of risk, this will continue to rise and the surge will continue.
Follow up?
Is any other data available, which I'm sure I can come to that too, showing the last 40 years, okay, what it was 40 years ago for the availability of marijuana today compared to 40 years ago?
I
then see what the chart looks like.
Yes, definitely. I will definitely try to find that data for you.
Okay, cool. Thank you very much.
Are there any further questions? Seeing none, thank you very much. Okay, the chair will call Lieutenant John and Parnassia. At this point, I'd like to announce we've gotten a lot of testimony, so if you have written testimony, please do not read your testimony. And we are interested in hearing new things, so please don't repeat testimony that we've already heard. Please.
Good morning, Madam Chair. My name is Johnny Panasco. I'm a lieutenant with the New Hampshire State Police, and I'm here representing the New Hampshire Department of Safety. And we're prepared for this. I have a handout that I just passed forward, and I'll highlight a few issues. Just based on some of the testimony I've already heard. First and foremost, there is a heroin crisis going on right now, and I believe this is the wrong time for decriminalization. And I believe that this simply sends the wrong message. You just heard from people involved with youth, and there's no doubt about it, the message that it sends to our children is wrong. In regards to the half-ounce quantities of marijuana, that's still a lot of marijuana. A half-ounce of marijuana, again, depending on how big you roll in your joints, can be up to 28 joints. That's not, you know, I believe somebody mentioned something about sharing. That's a lot of marijuana. You're talking penalties for a first offense for $100. You're basically saying that, you know, we have fines for speeding that are much greater than that. A $100 fine for, for a civil possession charge is nothing more than a slap on the wrist. In regards to simple possession, currently many times there is an arrest involved. Just recently, speaking from my experience, just recently came into contact with someone with a small quantity of marijuana. They were released on a hand summons, a must appear, have to go to court. They weren't taken into custody. And I don't know where that lies right now, if there's going to be a trial or anything, but there wasn't a physical arrest that took place. So the process has been dumbed down, so to speak, as far as there's not a full-blown arrest that goes on many instances. And again, it depends on the circumstances. There's a number of confusing and complicated parts of this legislation. For instance, the plea by mail section. What happens if you're dealing with a minor? Is there still plea by mail? Or how do you get this person into the system? What happens if it's a subsequent offense? Are they taken into custody? What's the fine? How do you write that? More importantly, there's a cost associated with the process of reprogramming the system, the court system, the DMV system, to remove the identifiable information that the bill requires the law enforcement to do. All these things are going to cost, and all these things are going to be problematic should this bill be passed. We would recommend that the bill be killed, just like it was with the committee. I believe that in the past, the bills that have come to the Senate from the House were different than this, and that's why the committee on this occasion decided to ITL the bill. I can answer any questions if you have any.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Don't you find that the inconsistency of arrests is confusing and is a problem? I mean, if you're a young person that gets caught by someone who's really going to go by the book, then you're in a lot more trouble than the kid that gets caught somewhere and somebody says, oh, youthful indiscretion.
Absolutely, Senator. And like I said, a lot of it will depend on circumstances, and a lot of it depends on the officer's discretion, much like any other crime. For instance, I can say, our troopers out on the road, the majority of the speeding tickets that are issued by those guys that have been on for a couple of years, they're much more aggressive. They have that line, this person's getting a ticket, they're less understanding. Sometimes it's good, sometimes it's not so good. In the instance of what I was mentioning with the hand summons that I issued, it was based on the circumstances that I was that I had. I wasn't dealing with an 18 and 19 year old individual. I had somebody that was tied to the community, had a permanent job, and basically my belief was this person was going to show up in court. There wasn't going to be a problem. Whether they decided to challenge the summons or plead not guilty, I didn't know what they were going to do, but I knew that this person was going to go before the court, and that was the same result I was going to get if I took them into custody, brought them in, took my time and energy, away from what I was doing as far as the operation I was involved in, and had to process them, have a bail commissioner come down, have them released, because they're not going to be held for a small quantity of marijuana. And the time and energy involved in that, it's simply not cost effective. At least it wasn't for me at the time, based on, the operation that I was involved in.
All I can say to that is, there you go. I mean, you just gave an argument to me as to why we should decriminalize.
Well, again,
to some degree.
To some degree, I'm not gonna say that that's the wrong move, but I feel that this bill is not.
All right, I appreciate that. Thank you.
Yes,
thank you. In your last sentence, you talk about other. is it fair to create a privacy shield for persons given tickets of possession of a controlled drug when compared with those who commit other violation level offenses? Could you give me an example of those other violation offenses?
My understanding is that anything that ties into the DMV and your license, your driver's license, for instance, that's all public record. This year, Bill, and again, my understanding of it is asking for us to remove certain identifiable information from the record. And that's much different. You know, somebody who has a driving offense, that's going to be public record. It's going to be, there's a way to get to that, a way to access that, as opposed to someone who has a marijuana offense, a violation, we're eliminating, we're protecting that person's identity, so to speak.
Thank you.
Can we see no further questions? Thank you very much, by the way.
Thank you.
And the next president to call up is Tracy Fowler. Is she here from the Governor's Commission?
Yeah. Thank you.
Welcome. Introduce yourself, please.
Yes, I will. My name is Tracy Fowler. I'm currently the chair of the Prevention Task Force underneath the Governor's Commission on Alcohol and Drugs Prevention, Treatment, and Recovery. However, I'm here testifying today on behalf of the full commission. So I do want to speak to a little bit of a nuanced approach to this. So for the record, the commission is in opposition to House Bill 1631. However, the commission is in support of Senate Bill 498, which I think you brought up earlier, which changes the penalty for the possession of marijuana from a Class A misdemeanor to an unspecified misdemeanor. Senate Bill 498 was already voted on by the Senate and the House, and it did pass the House Criminal Justice Committee with unanimous vote. Derek, so I want to give you a little bit of background on the development of that bill. During the fall of 2014, New Futures convened a cross-section of key stakeholders from the state's court system, business community, medical community, substance abuse treatment and prevention organizations, community coalitions, youth programs, law enforcement, public defenders, and higher education. So it was quite a mix of stakeholders from across our state, from many different sectors. And they convened this group to gather, review, and reflect on information relative to marijuana use and legislation. So to put some thought behind this, essentially, having a knee-jerk reaction. So I did participate in this group on behalf of the Prevention Task Force, and the group met four times between September 2014 and November 2014. The discussion and reflections that we had led to a shared goal of reducing use of marijuana, particularly among youth, as you heard, an extremely vulnerable population for addiction, and the development of addiction in the brain, and of protecting public safety. So we reached unanimous consensus that RSA 318-B26 should be amended to provide that possession of a small amount of marijuana should be charged as an unspecified misdemeanor, which really speaks to a lot of the concerns that you've heard folks raise in terms of people getting, you know, changing their life course because they've ended up with a charge on their record. SB 498 is in line with the recommendations from the group of key stakeholders. As SB 498 proposes, by changing the current statute to reflect a single fine amount, the differentiated fine will not trigger a related statute that is currently interpreted by some judges and prosecutors to render them unable to allow a plea bargain from a misdemeanor to a violation. But this change to an unspecified misdemeanor for first offenses will allow A, classification as a misdemeanor B, that would not require court appearance as a penalty. B, it would allow more uniform application of state marijuana laws, reducing sentencing inequities, which we did discuss. and C, allow prosecutorial flexibility not to impose criminal penalty or establish a criminal record for first-time offenders who have not posed a risk to others. As stated above, SB 498 is in line with the recommendations from this group of key stakeholders, and HB 1631 is not, for all of the reasons that you've heard described earlier. You know, it's definitely vaguely written. I think it's a poor bill as proposed. So that is, oh, and I did want to mention, I can answer questions, but I did want to mention, the other piece that has come up that I think is important to note is that we are embarking as a state on a pretty big cultural change with our therapeutic cannabis program. That's really just getting started. The dispensaries are going to be opening in this spring and this summer. I think we owe it to our communities to implement that effectively and safely before we do something like a blanket decriminalization. So I did just want to also mention that as a piece of information.
Thank you. Any questions?
Sure. We heard, thank you for coming in today. We heard testimony earlier that in order to enhance the perception of risk of marijuana, that penalties should be increased to make penalties harsher. Mm. That obviously is not the conclusion of the task force. So in considering the question of how to enhance the perception of risk of this drug, because you said that was your, not enhancing the perception, but to combat the use was your prime target. Did the task force address the question of how to enhance the perception of risk? And what was their conclusion on that question?
Yeah, that's a very good question. I think that an important point. And I think that what we have in New Hampshire is a perfect storm of hardly any funding for prevention, treatment, and recovery supports in our state. And so, and the increased availability of things like prescription drugs, which have led us down a path, and overprescribing, which have led us down the path toward this opiate epidemic that we're in. However, on the piece that we're speaking of in terms of marijuana, the lack of dollars for prevention really inhibits our effort to do much in terms of education and providing supports and providing alternative sentencing and providing juvenile diversion. You know, I think when you really start to peel back some of the layers of this onion, you really start to see that, you know, I said perfect storm, I mean, it kind of has been because of our lack of dedicated funding to this issue. Because prevention really does start in, high school is kind of the end game in some ways. I mean, the prevention needs to begin in early years. And research is now coming out to really support that. So I think that, you know, we're not looking to add harsher penalties, we're looking to add more upstream, you know, to add more work happening in the prevention aspect and to add more work happening to support families. So I think that, I think your question is on point.
There's also testimony that marijuana is 3 times a multiplier for use of heroin. And we're going to get that CDC report, so I'd like to read that. But are you aware of that CDC report?
I am. And I think that one way to think of it is that when you're exposing a developing brain to any substance, it increases the likelihood of addiction, period. I think, you know, we are hyper-focused on an opiate epidemic, which I completely understand, but I think we need to think of it as an addiction epidemic. When opiates go away, something else will come up. And it's really that we need to be combating addiction and looking at addiction more comprehensively and more thoughtfully, and how does it begin? How do we line people up? The woman from Katie mentioned one of the scariest statistics that I've heard in my career, as I'm a social worker by trade, I'm a preventionist by trade, was that we're hearing from youth that they're using because they're stressed out. That literally gives me goosebumps, because what we are seeing is that they're their coping skills are not, they're not in existence. Their coping skills are, I will use a substance. That's very scary. That to me points right down the road toward addiction. And so if we want to change this epidemic and this trajectory we're on, we have to start working with kids at a younger level to help them build resiliency, to help them understand how to cope with life. Because using substances is not it. It's, you know, whether it's alcohol, whether it's marijuana, that's what they're starting with. They're not starting with heroin. You know, they're not a 14-year-old or a 12-year-old or an 11-year-old has access to, easier access to things like alcohol, to things like marijuana. And that's, that use of any substance at that age is scary, is dangerous.
So I want to ask the same question I asked them, is that, is it then the position of the task force or the committee that you represent, is that marijuana, the relationship between marijuana use and opioid use or harsher drugs generally, or addiction as you put it, is that a correlative relationship only, or is it a causal relationship? Does one necessarily lead to the other?
Well, I do think that one does lead to the other.
What's the evidence for that?
The evidence is our increase in addiction and our rates of youth use of alcohol, of marijuana, of tobacco. Those are kind of the big three entry points, if you will. And I also would, you know, I would also encourage us to think carefully about, you know, when you're asking that question, and what is your distinction between a correlative relationship and a causal? What depending on the answer, what would you go down a different path? I'm just wondering.
Yes, we can talk about that.
Yeah.
I mean, I think there's a difference when you make policy.
Right.
Where you're looking at merely things that happen to coincide versus something that does cause something else.
Yes. No.
You know,
I
think all policy choices are different.
Well, it's definitely not happenstance. I think there's plenty of evidence to support that. I think that it's less of a knee-jerk war on drugs, don't do drugs, drugs are bad reaction, and more of a deeper dive into addiction and brain science and looking at, like I said, exposure to any substance alters the brain chemistry in a way that lines someone up for addiction, especially as a young person when they're learning to cope, and how they learn to cope with life is to ingest a substance which makes them feel good. And so in order to recreate that, they need to ingest more of a substance because they haven't learned how to feel good or to manage without it.
That's awesome. You also testified that the bill was vaguely worded.
Yeah.
Have you done an analysis that you produced for the committee to show what is vague, what's ambiguous, what should be cleaned up if we were to pass the bill?
I have not specifically, but I know New Futures, who is going to be testifying, will be able to speak a little bit more to that.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that, like I said, I think the commission is in favor of Senate Bill 498, because mm-hmm. I do think it speaks to a lot of the issues that were raised. I think this Decrim bill presents more of a liability in that regard.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Any further questions? All right, thank you very much.
Sure.
David Goldstein.
Thank you so much.
Mr. Goldstein, thank you for coming.
Good morning, Mr. Chair, members of the committee. For the record, my name is David Goldstein, Chief of Police, City of Franklin. I'm representing the New Hampshire Association of Chiefs of Police, and I do have some handouts for the committee.
Thank you, sir.
I will be very, very brief because you've already heard a lot of what I have to say, and you will be hearing more from people far better equipped to speak about this than myself. Been a police officer for 37 years, and I'm here today to testify in opposition to HB 1631 on behalf of myself, as well as the New Hampshire Association of Chiefs of Police. There are going to be a number of issues that this bill will raise. You've heard about the fact that we've already worked on reducing the penalty from a Class A misdemeanor to an undifferentiated misdemeanor. And I heard a question from Senator Lasky about whether or not there was any kind of consistency. Quite frankly, this will add consistency because up till now, even the courts were inconsistent. The committee meetings that we had over last summer with Judge Kelly there, for example, indicated that even with the Class A misdemeanor, which by statute the courts had to follow, many courts were not. So by way of example, I would ask a couple of practical questions of this committee relative to this bill. We are looking at specific amounts in the bill, up to a half an ounce of marijuana, up to 5 grams of hashish. The officer, police officer, state trooper, fishing game officer on the road, how does he or she know that that's what it is? Is this committee willing to amend the bill so to give us the authority to make those decisions on the street rather than sending these cases to the state police forensic lab, which, by the way, has told us on many occasions they will not analyze these samples, they're so small. If they did, it would take 12 to 18 months before we even saw a result, which means the accused would be sitting in a position of a sort of Damocles, waiting for the hammer to fall as to whether or not this was more than a half an ounce, less than a half an ounce, or so on. I can issue my police officers digital scales that they can use. I can issue and let them make the determination. But again, we don't have that authority statutorily or even practically to make such determinations. That's why we have a forensic lab. As has already been stated, we're in a crisis. We're in a crisis. I'm not sure what people want us to do anymore, to be quite frank. Here we are on the one hand, we're decrying an opioid crisis that's nationwide. And as was already stated, after we solve this problem, and we will, what's next in line? When I was undercover back in the 80s, it was cocaine and marijuana. Heroin was still there. Opioids were still there. Nothing has changed. Now I'm hearing that methamphetamine is making a comeback. Now I'm hearing that they're mixing fentanyl with methamphetamine, and that the fentanyl is the issue. I see this, as Ms. Fowler said, as an ongoing addiction problem, not an opioid or marijuana or whatever problem. This is a drug problem. And we will do whatever we're told to do in law enforcement. That's our job. But if you're going to ask for our opinion, we're telling you this is not good law by any stretch of the imagination. For 5 years exactly of that, 37 years that I've been a police officer, I was a police chief in Massachusetts, just outside of Boston, the Boston metropolitan area. My police department, my community sat between Revere and East Boston. That was the time when Massachusetts decided to decriminalize small amounts of marijuana. I can tell you, not only anecdotally, but experientially, that that was a very bad move. We were looking at robberies, thefts, assaults, and what have you. Give me your grass type of thing. It was a $100 fine, no limit on the fines. Every time you get caught with it, you paid $100 just like a parking ticket, you moved on to the next one. When I went to the city council, and not council, but council, the city solicitor, and asked what we should do, his frustrated opinion was, don't do anything. Let them smoke what they want and move on. Is that really what New Hampshire wants? Because that's what we're going to get if we're not careful. The YRBS just came out, the most recent. I believe Ms. Fowler also referred someone to that, and you'll hear a little bit more. I will just tell you, I heard a question about access. According to the latest numbers, which go back to 2013-2014, for marijuana, of the students surveyed, 74% said that access was easy to these substances. There's our problem, is the children. That's who we're most responsible for. Adolescents now, neuroscientists tell us, goes to 25, not 18 like we used to, but 25 years of age. 25, you can be a surgeon. and be operating on someone and be high. At 25, you can be an airline pilot for a large airline and fly people high. And the change, the neurological and changes are there. The prefrontal and the frontal lobes, which are responsible for executive functioning and for emotion, they change. Marijuana has that, and you'll see that in some of the handouts I passed out. In Franklin, we think we found part of the solution. And I'm not just saying that because I am from Franklin. I think we have found part of the solution. We have the Franklin Managed Drug Task Force. We have decided to look at prevention, not just treatment. We've decided to take a very public health point of view and look at our children and see how do we intervene so that we can stop this problem, so that we can stem this problem, and so that we can reduce some of the numbers that the YRBS shows us. We are in the second 5 year, what will be a 10-year grant, close to $500,000 grant. Communities do not get grants like this very often. We were able to get it first time out from the federal government. We're one of very, very few communities in the state that is doing this right now. I invite any members of this committee, any members of the audience to come to our meetings. They are open meetings. We hold them once a month. And listen to, it's a completely eclectic group. Everybody is represented. Everybody has an equal voice in that committee. And I think we're making some very, very significant inroads in combating this problem. And with that, I'll take any questions the committee might have.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning.
Good morning.
Do you remember in Senate Bill 498 much of the same testimony you've given? I don't remember the huge story about it.
I believe, and I think I made a reference that I was trying not to use. I believe so. If you just give me a moment. Yes, we supported 498 relative to the penalties for possession of a certain amount.
So you supported that?
Yes, 498, correct.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Our next question will be Devin Chaffee. How do you say your first name?
You said it correctly, Senator Cataldo. It's Devin Chaffee. That is my name for the record. Senator Cataldo and other honorable members of the committee. For the record, my name is Devin Chaffee, and I am the executive director of the ACLU of New Hampshire, and I am here once again to testify in support of marijuana decriminalization, this time in the form of HB 1631. And as I was preparing my testimony, and I was thinking, you know, sort of what could I add to the testimony that I've already given before this committee, including to the committee as it is today, last year? And I was just really thinking that just, you know, I've testified in favor of decriminalization every year since I come to the state of New Hampshire. And every single year, it seems to me that there is greater evidence that, in fact, if New Hampshire is to join the rest of New England and the increasing number of states that have decriminalized marijuana, that, in fact, the sky will not fall. And that all the parade of horribles that are so often listed as the horrible things that will happen if New Hampshire decides to decriminalize marijuana will not, in fact, occur, because they have not, in fact, occurred in other states that have taken the steps to decriminalize, and that's why you haven't seen a repeal of these statutes once they're passed. Other states that have decriminalized are very content to divert law enforcement resources away from going after arresting for small possessions of marijuana, and to instead deploy those resources in other ways that are more effective and more important to the citizens of their state. I want to address some of the issues that came up regarding, you know, has decriminalization in other states, in fact, led to worse outcomes for youth? Has it, in fact, increased teen youth? Has it, is there, in fact, any evidence at all that shows a causal relationship between marijuana and the use of other drugs? And I want to first cite a couple of studies that have in fact demonstrated that marijuana decriminalization hasn't resulted in harmful consequences for teenagers. And in fact, there was a 2011 study, a more recent study about California's law, which went into effect in 2011, that found that in fact in California, marijuana decriminalization did not have harmful consequences for teenagers. And there was a 2013 UNICEF report that similarly indicated that countries that have decriminalized marijuana do not experience higher rates of youth marijuana use. And in fact, that is why in early 2015, last year, the American Academy of Pediatrics actually came out in strong support of decriminalization, looking at the studies of 11 initial states that decriminalized marijuana in the 1970s and demonstrated that there have been no sharp increase in use rates. And in fact, the reason why they came out in favor of decriminalization is because the criminalization of marijuana and how that can often lead to youth being pulled into the criminal justice system can have a number of negative impacts for youth, which is why the Academy decided to take a position. In addition, a March 2013 Pew Research Center poll found that there was in fact no significant difference in lifetime or recent use between people in states with some form of legalized marijuana and those in other states. And so all of this is to say that decriminalizing marijuana has not led to skyrocketing use rates among adults, and it hasn't had negative impacts, at least as not as have been demonstrated in these studies, for teenagers. And I think that's very important to take these studies, which are in peer review academic journals, to heart when considering whether or not New Hampshire should go forward. I also want to address this question as to whether or not, in fact, using marijuana, there's the gateway theory, right? We're all familiar with the gateway theory. Yeah, I think it originated sometime, maybe in the early 1990s, I'm not sure, maybe before that. But the gateway theory has been disproven, again, year after year, study after study, that shows that there is, in fact, no evidence that the use of marijuana is causally linked to the use of other illicit substances. And in fact, probably the most prominent report to this effect is a study by the National Academy of Sciences Institute of Medicine. It's a 1999 report that concludes, and I quote, "There is no conclusive evidence that the drug's effects of marijuana are causally linked to the subsequent abuse of other illicit drugs. There is no evidence that marijuana serves as a stepping stone on the basis of its particular physiological effect. And in fact, it's simply the status of marijuana as being criminalized that may, in fact, lead to making it a quote-unquote gateway drug in the way that it introduces individuals into the criminal justice system." And a more recent study in 2015 by the American Journal of Drug and Alcohol Abuse found that marijuana use within itself wasn't a risk factor for use of other drugs, and in fact that most teens who use marijuana do not progress to other drugs. In fact, this study found that there are other factors going on in teens' lives that are more likely to contribute to the use of other illicit substances, not simply the use of marijuana. And it's very important to understand the difference between simply correlation, which perhaps the CDC study that was cited earlier, and causation. There are a lot of things that coexist simultaneously where one does not necessarily cause the other. And what these studies have shown is that there is no evidence of a causal relationship between the use of marijuana and other drugs. And I'd be happy that I do have written testimony here. Not all of those citations are in my written testimony, but I will follow up with an email to the report citing the studies that I've discussed here today. Another thing that struck me as I was preparing for this testimony is, again, coming year after year, is that year after year there is another poll, more polling done in the state of New Hampshire, that show that year after year there is stronger support for decriminalization every single year in the state of New Hampshire. As was stated before, 65% of individuals in New Hampshire support full legalization, and only 20% of people in New Hampshire want this legislature to keep the current status where individuals are being arrested for marijuana possession. And so what this bill does is essentially is the will of the New Hampshire citizens at this point in time. They don't want their taxpayer money being used for marijuana possession enforcement and arrests. It also strikes me again every year that I come and I testify in support of decriminalization is the incredible expense that marijuana, that continued criminalization of marijuana, possession of small amounts of marijuana in the state of New Hampshire. And I've shared with you these figures before, but I will share with you these figures again, that it's approximately, according to an ACLU study, $6.5 million spent in a single year on marijuana possession. The other interesting data point, particularly interesting data point on the infographic that's being distributed is that there was discussion earlier about the fact that marijuana possession charges, there's no uniformity over how judges and prosecutors and police handle these cases throughout the state. And perhaps that's why in New Hampshire, if you are black, you are 2.6 times more likely to be arrested for a possession of small marijuana than if you are not black. And this is not surprising in particular. In fact, it's very similar to other states that continue to criminalize marijuana throughout the country, have similar disparities, which is part of why decriminalization, and perhaps is the main reason why decriminalization has for so long and continues to be a priority for the American Civil Liberties Union, not just here in New Hampshire, but nationally. And so these are, you know, this, every single year, I think that the case for why New Hampshire should join the rest of the states that have decriminalized, that have already decriminalized possession of small amounts of marijuana just gets stronger. As we see states that have gone down this road continue to be happy with the decision that they've made. But I didn't want to leave here today without touching on the cases of a couple of individuals that have been particularly impacted by our marijuana possession laws this year. And I want to start with Jeffrey Pendleton, who Representative Cushy mentioned earlier. This is Jeffrey Pendleton. He's a 26-year-old man. He was a former client of the ACLU of New Hampshire in a number of cases involving law enforcement harassment of the poor and homeless. Jeff Pendleton recently died in Valley Street Jail after being arrested in part on a marijuana possession of small amounts of marijuana charge. He was unable to make his $100 bail that was set. And on the third to fourth day of in Valley Street, he was apparently found dead in his cell. Should Jeff have been in jail at all is the question. If he continued to be unable to pay that $100 bail, he would have spent a month in jail. So I'm gonna share with you, a recent story by The Guardian. It's a newspaper out of London, actually, that has covered Jeff's case. He's gotten quite a bit of attention because his case hits on a number of issues surrounding the inequities in our criminal justice system here in the United States and here in the state of New Hampshire. And I think that the penalties for possession of small amounts of marijuana is one of those pertinent issues that Jeff's case touched on. The other case that I wanted to quickly bring your attention to, some of you may have read in the Valley News, the case of Tom Orkney. Tom Orkney, have you heard that case? Tom Orkney was in his home. Apparently, police were in his building responding to an instance of domestic violence. Someone thought that they smelled pot, so they entered his apartment. They found a small box with, I think, what they think is approximately a half ounce of marijuana. Tom had actually had legally obtained the marijuana through a dispensary in a state where he did, in fact, have legal authority to obtain and possess that amount of marijuana. He was a veteran who suffered brain injury because of his service, and he had the medical marijuana to treat those symptoms. However, he was arrested and he was charged. The police alleged that because he had been in the state for over 30 days, that he was no longer a visiting patient, which technically under New Hampshire's medical marijuana statute, you could interpret it that way. And so they proceeded with his case. And as of the publication of this last article, his case has yet to have been resolved. And Tom continues to be in limbo, even though he obtained the marijuana from a legal source. So this idea that people are not being arrested for possession of small amounts of marijuana, I think, just does not get there borne out. And in fact, the Valley News really looked into this case as an example of what was going on in Lebanon. And what they found was that the department last year engaged in there were 157 arrests for marijuana possession, and that they estimated that's approximately three what they call pot busts a week. So the idea that, again, that people aren't being arrested for marijuana possession in New Hampshire is simply not the case. I'm going to circulate this article describing Tom's case. I want to quickly say that SB 498, which this committee and the Senate has passed and has gone on to the House, is not decriminalization. In fact, SB 498, it does in fact raise the mandatory minimums for drug possession crimes, and then simply gives more discretion to prosecutors and judges, but it is not what we would consider to be a decriminalization bill. And that it doesn't take it out of that criminalization framework. And I also just want to address why I really believe that decriminalization of marijuana is completely in line with the way that this legislature has chosen to approach drug addiction in this state this session. The legislature has, I think, very wisely decided to put its emphasis on prevention and treatment instead of on increased criminal penalties and increased criminalization. And I think that emphasis is in the right place. And I think passage of a decriminalization bill would be completely in line with that approach. Let's take the resources, let's take the $6.5 million that New Hampshire is spending on enforcing marijuana possession laws in this state, and let's plow it into other more effective ways of addressing addiction as a public health issue first, instead of as a criminal issue, a criminal justice issue. And with that, I want to thank you for this opportunity to testify, and again urge you to vote in support of HB 1631. Thank you very much.
Any questions,
Senator? Thank you. You asked the question, why was Jeffrey in jail at all? Shouldn't the question really be, why was Jeffrey using substances that were illegal?
Well, so I think the question is, do we believe that jail time, do we believe that possession of a very small amount of marijuana for personal use, do we believe that the fitting sentence for that, which would have been the case if Jeffrey had lived, is the fitting punishment for that 30 days in jail? In my opinion, it's not. I think that is the question that we should be asking ourselves. Does the punishment fit what the offense in this case? I think that that justice would have been better served had Jeffrey simply faced a violation level offense, which is still there's a penalty associated with it. But he wouldn't have gone to jail. He wouldn't have spent 3 days in jail, and then he wouldn't have been looking to spend another 27 days in jail for such a minor offense. I think that is a punishment that more appropriately fits the violation that Jeffrey engaged in.
Follow up?
Sure.
As in politics, we get studies from both sides. What makes your studies more credible than those that we have received from others saying that marijuana does have effects on teenagers?
Well, I don't want to be clear. I am not advocating for teen use. I believe that there are probably many valid studies that show that marijuana use is not good for teenagers. I certainly don't believe that teenagers should be engaging in use of marijuana. So I'm not refuting those particular medical studies that should they exist. What I'm saying is that I haven't seen any studies that show that there's a causal relationship between either decriminalizing marijuana and increased teen usage, given that we now have 20 states that have over 20 states that have decriminalized. And I haven't, and there are studies, in fact, that show that there is no causal relationship. And I'm also not aware of any studies that show that there's a causal relationship between marijuana use and then use of other illicit substances. And in fact, there are studies that show that, in fact, marijuana use, there is no proven causal relationship between marijuana use and use of other illegal substances. So, I mean, obviously there are different studies that will prove different things, but I'm not aware, and I haven't heard cited here today, any demonstration of that causal relationship. What I did hear cited was a CDC study that showed that it's more, if you use heroin, it's more likely that you will have used marijuana, but that doesn't prove that the marijuana use is actually leading to heroin use. And I think it's that causality that is really important when you're considering what is the impact of a policy actually going to be.
One of the things we received is a study that says brain changes are associated with casual marijuana use in young adults. And I'm just curious as to why we should believe that the studies you're looking at are credible and things like this are not.
I don't think that this, thank you, Senator. I think that's a very good question, but I want to be clear. I don't think that those conclusions, that the conclusions of the studies that I cited and the conclusions that you just cited, I don't think that they're in contradiction with each other. I don't think anybody here today is arguing that teen use is not at all harmful. I don't think anyone here is taking that position, and certainly none of the studies that I've cited are trying to demonstrate that. I think we all believe and we believe the state should be engaged in education about the potential negative impacts on youth for those youth that engage in marijuana usage. The question is, from a policy standpoint, by criminalizing marijuana, are we actually making it so that fewer teens are smoking marijuana or using marijuana? And I think what the studies show is that teens in states where marijuana has been decriminalized are no more likely to use marijuana than teens in states where marijuana is still criminalized. And so this policy, yes, marijuana teen use is we don't want to encourage that, obviously, but this policy choice, the idea that by decriminalizing marijuana and making it so that the punishment better fits the crime, it is not, according to the studies, there's no evidence that that's going to lead to any increase in teen use. And that's what the studies that I was citing show, as well as the fact there's also no studies that use of marijuana is going to lead to use of harder illicit substances.
Any further questions? Thank you very much.
Thank you,
Senator. We're down to two people now, two persons. Susan McQueen, Julian.
She just stepped out to the ladies' room. She'll be right back.
How about Paul Toomey? She'll be the last person on the list. Is anyone else after who's on the list?
Okay,
thank you. Thanks, Kate.
Thank you, Senator. My name is Paul Toomey. I'm from Chichester. I'm here representing myself. Briefly, a way of background, I spent 35 years as a criminal defense lawyer. I think certainly represented at least 1,000 people charged with possession of small amounts of marijuana during that time. I've also been the House Legal Counsel. And recently, I was privileged to represent Linda Horan, who you may remember was the cancer patient who sued the state over access to medical marijuana. I'm here in support of this bill for a number of reasons, and I'll try to be as brief as possible because a number of my points have already been made, but while I was testifying, I went on my smartphone, which I misused, and I apologize for that. I hit a button that made a sound. But I did look up the CDC study, and CDC study from 2015, and it says that there's a correlation, and it doesn't address the question of causation between marijuana use and heroin. There are, in fact, to my knowledge, no studies that show any causative relationship, and that should be what you're concerned with. Clearly, if somebody is addicted to heroin, there probably going to be some increase in likelihood that they're used out of the substances. And that's all the CDC's study shows, other than the fact that that risk is less for marijuana than for other substances that we don't criminally arrest people for, including alcohol and tobacco. There are other studies that show, the AMA last summer released a study that showed that in states that have authorized access to medical marijuana for pain, there is a 24.8% decrease, this is across the country, in the number of opiate overdose deaths. Now that's a 25% decrease in the first year of access to medical marijuana. What I'm really here to talk to you about is those. It's about our criminal justice system. In the course of representing about 1,000 people, I don't believe I've ever had a client be sentenced to a sentence to go to serve a sentence as a punishment for marijuana. I've seen that happen. People that it happens to are poor people. More often it happens to, as the ACLU director indicated, to people of minority races. They're far more likely than white people to get sentenced or to be arrested for marijuana. And the only people that get jail sentences for marijuana after going to court are poor people. And that means we have two systems of justice. The police officer who testified for the state police, I think said some very important things, but I draw the opposite conclusions that he drew. He said that he came to the conclusion that one particular arrest, that his time was better spent doing other types of police work than doing all the paperwork involved with a misdemeanor arrest. A misdemeanor arrest requires the police officer to spend a couple of hours back at the station, takes them off the streets. They have to prepare a full report. Violations aren't usually handled that way. They write a little brief thing on the back of the ticket because most violations get paid without trial. So all that time that he made the correct decision, I believe, in my opinion, in choosing to use his time fighting far more serious offenses than marijuana. I do disagree with him that in the way he made that decision, though. He said he looked at the person, and what I gathered from it was that it was a middle-class person, not a kid. And that he's just, those were things that he took into account. I don't think those are proper things to take into account. I think a young 18-year-old kid, if you look at a kid that looks like Mr. Patterson in that picture, should get the same procedural treatment from our criminal justice system as a banker or a banker's son should get. And the problem we have here is that's not what's happening here today. Somebody like Mr. Patterson, the jail superintendent, he'd been in jail before for not paying fines, and the jail superintendent said he was a very nonviolent, cooperative person. I went down to the Nashua court system to look at his file because I was disturbed by the fact that he died in jail on something like this. And I spoke to the chief prosecutor for Nashua, and he told me he was a nice young man who wasn't any problem whatsoever. But he ended up being treated differently than 99% of the people there, and we can speculate as to the reasons, and I even think it had something to do with the fact that he sued the police, but the fact of the matter is he shouldn't have been in a jail cell for something that 99% of the people don't ever go to jail for. He shouldn't have been arrested, he shouldn't have been brought to the police station in handcuffs, he shouldn't have been denied a personal recognizance bail, and we've got a system that allows people to have the discretion to make those decisions for bad reasons. We shouldn't have it. Now, we've heard that we have a serious substance abuse problem in New Hampshire. That's undoubtedly true. We have very high rates of usage of all substances. Alcohol, I think if we're not first, we're right up there in the top. We heard we're in the top 10 in marijuana use of teens. We certainly have a horrible problem with opiate prescribed medication overdoses. Those are with the current system where marijuana and other drugs are treated as a criminal law problem. These things are better treated as health problems And the resources that we're putting into tying up cops are better used funding treatment programs. Why is it that the only state in New Hampshire, the only state in New England that hasn't decriminalized marijuana is the state with the highest rates of use, of teenage use of marijuana? If that is the solution, why hasn't it worked? Why has decriminalizing marijuana not caused spikes in Massachusetts, Rhode Island, Connecticut, and Vermont? Maine decriminalized marijuana 40 years ago. If all these horrible things will happen after the decriminalization of marijuana, why hasn't Maine had a bill? I mean, nobody's even filed a bill in years in Maine to recriminalize marijuana. I sat here 10 years ago and listened to somebody from the Attorney General's office talk about all the horrible things that were going to happen in Massachusetts when they decriminalized marijuana. None of those things have happened. And Massachusetts not only hasn't moved to recriminalize it, they're moving to actually legalize it probably next fall. But for whether they legalize it or don't legalize it, they've come to the determination that it doesn't make sense to tie up cops, to use all that money on a criminal justice system when you could be addressing health problems. And I don't deny it, Senator Daniel said there are studies that indicate that there are problems with teenage use of substances like marijuana. There are other studies that disagree with that. But I don't dispute that whatsoever. I'd like to say the smart way to deal with it is not through cops. It's through doctors, it's through nurses, it's through health programs, and that's what we should be funding the state. And I live in a small town, we just had to add another police officer. Okay? One of the reasons we had to add another police officer is because a huge amount of their time is spent processing cases like marijuana cases that make no sense, that they don't help in any way to curb the problem. So I would urge you to join all the other states that surround us in New England and to stop using our police officers to treat a health problem. When people have problems with caffeine addiction, alcohol addiction, or tobacco addiction, we don't put them in jails. We don't. I mean, we tried it with alcohol. It was a horrible mistake. All it did was drive up the people stopped drinking weak substances like beer and started drinking alcohol, whiskey and strong substances because it was easier to sell. That's what criminalization does. Criminalization of marijuana has caused the same thing over the past 40 years. You now have very potent strains of marijuana because that's what's easier for the dealers to move and do things like that. I urge you to treat this like the health problem that it is. Thank you.
Any questions?
I have one. Sure. I just want to give you some information. Sure. I remember 40 years ago when I was working in Connecticut, and one of the men used to drive to Maine, pick up the marijuana, and then sell it to the guys in Connecticut. That's what they were doing 40 years ago.
I guess I can't respond to that other way and say that every state around us does it now. I've never dealt with a case with somebody going to get a small amount of marijuana from one state and bringing it into New Hampshire. I don't think that happens.
Maybe do a follow up on that one. What's a small amount?
Well, we're talking here under half ounce. Oh, I mean, as this bill indicates. Clearly, though, people do import drugs from other states. No doubt about that.
Any other questions? Yes, Senator.
And maybe I should have addressed this question to Ms. Chafee because she raised it. But the question just crystallized. It was you're testifying, Ms. Chafee testified that the studies show a correlative relationship, but not a causative relationship. Yeah. And Ms. Chafee went a step further in saying that by bringing these people into the criminal justice system, that may be contributing to part of drug use. Maybe I misheard that. Maybe I should address this with her, but as a criminal defense lawyer, what is your experience?
Well, I think that's the position of the, I can't remember, it's the American Pediatric Society, in their report that they issued in urging states to decriminalize, they said that the biggest bad effect with marijuana is when kids get into a criminal justice system, and all kinds of bad effects happen to their lives, one of which is they get exposed to other people that are criminals in other senses, and they learn bad things, but it also, because it affects their ability to get jobs, educations, things like that, it sends them on a spiral downward. So I think both things happen. I don't know that, I can't think of a single human being that ever told me that going to jail helped them with their marijuana problem. I mean, I truly can't. I just can't think of anybody ever said that. And I've talked to people, you know, thousands of times about how it changed their lives and what they could do to change their lives. And in terms of substance abuse, it's always been either something from their family, something from the community, or something from medical intervention that turns people on.
And in this debate about, I'm not sure how we call it a debate, but in the talking about the concept of correlation versus causation, the point of that for me is, if it's correlation, then we have one set of policy choices to make. If it's causation, we have another set of policy choices to make. Would you say that if it is true that the relationship between marijuana use and harder drug use is merely correlative, then this is an appropriate response? This bill would be an appropriate response?
I think it would be appropriate. I'm not sure the inverse is necessarily true. I think what you would need to know is which approach makes more sense in dealing with the problem that you face with, whether it's causative or not causative. If it makes more sense, if you're going to do more by using the criminal justice system, then you use the criminal justice system. But if that doesn't make the situation better, then you don't do that, because that has a horrible effect on people's lives. I mean, being arrested, put in handcuffs, taken to jail, getting a record, none of those things help people become productive people in society. Now, if there's some reasons to do those things when we have to do it, but there doesn't seem to be, to me, to be much evidence that it, in the situation of personal use of marijuana in small amounts, that that helps in any way whatsoever.
Thank you. Any other questions? Well, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much.
All right, Kate, you can come up now.
Yes, Susan, I don't advocate.
Kate Frey, correct?
No, Susan McKeown. I was out of the room at the ladies' room.
Oh, okay, thank you.
I appreciate it. Thank you.
Can you state your name, please?
My name is Susan McKeown. I'm here for the Children's Behavioral Health Collaborative, and I am asking you to defeat House Bill 1631. As a parent of four adult children, 40 years as a nurse practitioner working with families over two generations, and now as a certified prevention specialist, dealing with issues around substance misuse, I am concerned about the passage of this bill due to public health and safety ramifications of it. My concern is heightened by the current epidemic, and that passage would send a very conflicting message. I have co-facilitated the FASTER Parent Support Group. FASTER is an acronym for Families Advocating Substance Treatment Education and Recovery in Manchester for the last 13 years every Tuesday evening. When we first started that group, it was parents of children who were smoking pot, skipping school, not keeping curfew, and generally being disruptive at home. Last week, when I looked around the group of 23 parents, all of whom their children were on heroin and or alcohol. And I have to note that heroin use was not the first drug of choice of any of these children. And I put children in quotes, they're 19 to 34 generally. But every parent states that their children started with marijuana. And I'm well aware that every person that smokes a joint does not go on to be a heroin addict. However, we do have some causal statistics, I think, through SAMHSA, the Center of Addiction, and NIDA, National Institute of Drug Addiction, that states that one out of six, or 16% of teens, and one out of nine adults, 9%, are predisposed genetically to move on to more serious drug progression. The difference is in your family history, just as we talk about asthma and diabetes and heart disease, if that's part of your family history, So as is addiction part of your family history with alcohol or drugs, you could be more predisposed to that being an issue for you. We just don't know who we are. And teens certainly don't know who they are. The difference is, as mentioned before, the teen brain is not fully developed until it's 25. They're exceedingly vulnerable, and we know in medicine that during a period of rapid growth, an organ is much more sensitive to adverse effects. And that's certainly the concern with teens. In my current position as family support coordinator, I help expand parent groups around the state for parents who are dealing with substance misuse issues. We currently have 16 of those groups in the state, out of necessity, I might say, and I have those here for you. We know from our experience with alcohol and cigarettes, when availability increases, access increases for those for whom it is not intended, and in this case, young people. When the perception of harm decreases, as it certainly would with the passage of this group, this bill, usage increases. And the bill refers to 1/2 ounce of marijuana. I think we've talked about this enough, but that's the equivalent of about 30 joints. And that certainly is a high personal usage, and I think we have to consider distribution at that point. We've spent decades and millions, if not billions of dollars, on educating the public on cigarettes and smoking. And we know the dangers of cigarettes, yet we know how addictive smoking is and how difficult it is to give up. Now we have a substance being presented that is primarily smoked. And we know marijuana alters the brain. That's why it's used. That's why children seek it. And I it's nice to follow these other speakers that address that, is what is it that we ought to be addressing with kids rather than making another substance more available to them? What is it that could help them deal with their stresses? In addition to these concerns, the one effect that regular marijuana will attest to is the ultimate motivator of killer. And we see this with our young people. And that has a significant effect on our state and productivity. We know from the Polygon study that was done a few years ago that alcohol and substance use costs our state $1.85 billion a year. That's a lot of money, a lot of money. There's no clear path in this bill for assessing individuals who are at risk for increased usage. And that's one of the things I don't want to see people put in jail for. We know discrimination is still alive in our country. We have to address those things. But on the other hand, kids should have an exit point where they can be assessed as to what kind of problems they're having, what other alternatives might help them deal with whatever it is they're using drugs for. And also adults to be able to be evaluated with evidence-based evaluation so that they can be sent on for any appropriate treatment that might be available. And any fines that are collected should go right into a fund for prevention, intervention, treatment, and recovery. And I think that would be a real stipulation. To say that there are a lot of people who smoke marijuana ignores the fact that there are a lot of people who do not smoke marijuana. And because there are loud cries to lessen the penalties without a well-thought-out plan of how this would impact our citizens is listening to the wrong outcry, I feel. Given the current epidemic that is especially dangerous time in our state and is not doing justice to the health and safety of all our citizens of all ages, and I would just end with the fact that we talk a lot about the surrounding states who have legalized or decriminalized marijuana. And I would say we also are the only state who does not have a sales or income tax. That has not made us change our decision on those things. So I don't think that's a valid argument to say we have to change because everybody else does. I thank you for your attention, and I'll leave a copy of this. And I'm
any
also
one question.
Yes.
In light of your experience or your working with you, and you say you're a nurse practitioner, preventionist, etc., how do you address the conclusion reached by the American Academy of Pediatrics that urges decriminalization?
Well, I think the reason is they don't want to see it go the judicial route in terms of going to jail, and I don't either, and I don't think anybody in here really wants to see that happen. I think Senate Bill 548 addresses that in a much better way. No, this should be treated, this is a disease, it should be treated with protocol, and that's a word I would throw out to you to really write down and think about. We all know, whether you're in medicine or you're a patient, we know protocol. You go in with chest pain or overweight, and this and this and this and this are going to happen. The lab test, the follow-up, the referrals, and then come back and see how you're doing, medication as needed. Substance abuse does not have that protocol at this point. We have wonderful silos. They're not connected yet. We're not evaluating kids at every single visit, expert, screening for brief intervention, referral for treatment. Being introduced, it's not universal yet in primary care or in the emergency rooms. It needs to be universal for every single citizen, no matter what we look like or smell like or what color we are. We get a universal screening so we can pick these things up. Then they go into an evidence-based assessment. And when that is determined that there is a problem here, they have options for treatment, whether it's intensive outpatient, residential, 12-step program, and that is followed up on. And they also get counseling. We need a lot of legs, if you will, my metaphor, under the table. One leg, throwing somebody in jail, does not do it, okay? But we need a thorough protocol to deal with this disease, and that's what we don't have right now.
Just one follow-up.
It sounds to me from your testimony that you support SB 498.
What I know of it, I do support it. I have not read it thoroughly, but
which
yes.
Makes it an undifferentiated misdemeanor. What distinction do you draw between your support for that approach and the approach that's outlined in this bill?
I don't like the amount that's in here, the half ounce, okay, for one thing. I don't think it gives any opportunity for any assessments to happen, okay? So it's not a tight bill. It's not a well-written bill. We need more of the reference to the protocol I was referring to, picking up your smoking joints, you have a half ounce on you, something's going on here. Let's see what kind of usage you really have, if this is qualifying more as a dependency or an addiction, and what needs to happen because of that.
Does SB 498 have the necessary provisions to address that concern?
I will have to read it more tightly. I just know that it's a little bit better written than this one, but I would certainly hope so.
Okay, if you could give us your analysis.
Okay, I will read that bill.
All right, thank you very much. Hey, make it brief if you can.
I will make it very brief. I will only hit the points that have not been hit upon so far. For the record, my name is Kate Fry. I'm the Deputy Director of New Futures. We're here today in opposition of 1631. I'll just point a few things out. I won't repeat what was said before. We feel that this bill still is not, it's not as well written as it could be. We note that one thing that it does say is in the case of a person under 18 who possesses 1/2 ounce, in addition to imposing a violation in the prior, the person's parents may require community service and drug education. And I want to note there's no such drug education or community service programs that exist right now, and 1631 does not provide the education, does not provide the support for that. I also want to say that there's, there's always this question we have been asking is, how does this bill deal with kind of marijuana-infused products such as edibles, things like we're seeing in other states? We've always kind of asked how that fits into the definitions in this law, so we still have those questions as well. I guess I respectfully disagree with what you may have heard from other folks before. I do believe there is causal relationships. There are studies out of California through Monitoring the Future that does show that decriminalization in California may have impacted increased youth use rates. Colorado's reports are very strong about the increased youth use rates since their legalization and decriminalization time period. I'm referring to the California report after they decriminalized marijuana as well. I also want to show you state that as far as this discussion on causal relationships, the real risk factor, I'm reading from the Washington Post article regarding the myths of heroin. and what they stated was the real risk factor for opiate addiction is youth. Like 90% of all addictions, the vast majority of prescription drug problems start with experimentation in adolescence or early adulthood, typically after alongside weed drinking, marijuana smoking, and cocaine use. This is from the Center for Addiction. Having a prior current addiction to another drug is the best predictor of developing problems with prescription drugs in the future. So I just wanted to, you know, say that along with what you heard from other speakers as well, as far as that goes. But even if you find that other states don't have that correlation between decriminalization and legalization, I would want to throw out there what I think Ms. Fowler said earlier, is that I'd like to know where they stand with their treatment, or excuse me, with prevention programs in their state. I think you heard earlier that, you know, prevention has been the first thing to be cut over the years. You know, we're starting to take a closer look at that now. Funding has been added back into treatment, still not much for prevention along the lines. And so, you know, I don't think the response would be, you know, harsher penalties. It would also be having to have a strong prevention infrastructure in place. And lastly, I do want to add too, we have to remember marijuana is an addictive substance. You know, this discussion of whether it's as addictive as others or is alcohol worse, it's still addictive. And I think we know that our state struggles with providing treatment for those who are facing addiction as it is right now, as we stand. So our concern is making another addictive substance, decriminalizing that, and what we're seeing is really, you know, an epidemic in the state. And then I also have for you, and I think Senator Daniels noted it too, a recent study about marijuana habit in early life shows strong correlation with altering the way the brain has developed, and it's a very good article that I will leave with you as well as my testimony.
Any questions?
Yeah, just one question,
Ms. Ryan. I am trying to peruse the bill quickly, and I can't find it. But the reference to community service and education, do you know?
It is.
Correct. Page
what? Thank you, Kate. I don't have anybody else. Yes.
Sorry, I didn't sign it. I have 30 seconds.
Sorry, big deal. I'll give you 30. I'll give you 29.
Yeah. I appreciate that. Thank you.
You're welcome.
My name is Dennis Goddard. I'm from Hopkins and representing no one but myself. I just wanted to say, Senator Cataldo, I didn't intend to testify, but you asked such an insightful question. I thought it deserved an answer. I would like, you know, you had pointed out that you had noted that when there was decriminalization in Maine, other surrounding states, they'd get an import. I am curious to know how the states of Maine and Massachusetts and Vermont deal with the continuous import from New Hampshire into their states of liquor, cars, and furniture. I would like to point out that any time there is a place where people have more freedom, there will be a market, and that freedom will export to some degree. I would love for New Hampshire to be a place that has more freedom.
Thank you.
Thank you.
No questions? Great, thanks a lot. Seeing now we're all done with this bill. Thanks. We're gonna open up House Bill 1681.